East Timor is one of the most volatile places on Earth, where martial arts, gang life, and ritualistic beliefs make a combustible cocktail.
I think we should go.
And violence has become a way of life.
Move a little bit, then I stab him.
You stab him, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. Did he die, though?
That's what they say.
The country has all the ingredients of a top tourist destination. White sand beaches, azure blue seas, and a tropical climate to match. However, there's trouble in paradise. A fifth of the population are said to be gang members, and violence is endemic. This highly religious tribal culture has a gang problem like no other I've encountered on my travels. There are hundreds of burnt-out buildings like this in East Timor, arson being one of the weapons used by the gangs, along with bows and arrows, poison darts and machetes. And though that may sound medieval, the hospitals and the cemeteries here bear testament to their effectiveness. There are growing concerns that the gangs are gaining political influence in this, the youngest democracy in the world. So I've come here to find out just how much power they actually wield.
Although it's the capital of East Timor, Dili is little more than a series of villages. It's scarred by burnt-out derelict buildings and internally displaced persons camps to house the victims of violence. Unemployment is running at 70%, and so is gang membership. The streets are full of UN vehicles, gang graffiti, and foreign troops. The situation is so bad here that the government has had to seek foreign help in dealing with its problems and the gangs that cause them. It's my first day, and I'm starting my search for East Timor's gangs by visiting the Australian peacekeepers who have agreed to show me some of the weapons they've confiscated.
G'day, Ross. Nice to see you.
My guide is Major Pete Conroy.
Yes, I mean, this is a small collection. I must point out that we've actually collected a much larger amount of weapons. In fact, we've collected enough weapons to fill this entire floor and some. Here's an example of some knives. I mean, very, very simple knives. This was actually worn by an individual using the straps around his head, and we found him using this as some sort of sign.
Also, you can pull them from there.
He was a force to be reckoned with.
Right.
Certainly. Here are some classics, the nunchuckers.
Yeah.
It actually
folds into a metal bar.
Folds in with the chain and then simply screws in. So it just appears, and someone could conceal that as a simple pole. Applying weapons for the psychological effect has been quite useful for local gang members in intimidating villagers and other locals in the area.
Of course.
Yeah.
These crude homemade weapons are very different from anything I've ever seen, though they can clearly do serious damage.
And this is your traditional bow and arrow, in that you have wire reinforced with some rubber band to create the arrow.
Can it hurt?
Can it hurt? It can kill.
I've been told that the best chance of making contact with the gangs was after dark. So I joined Major Conroy's section on night patrol.
This is the most violent place in East Timor.
Really?
Yeah. This is known as Biro Pity.
Yeah.
And essentially from last year through to this year, yeah. This has been where the majority of the fighting has taken place.
Well, but why is it so violent in this particular place, mate?
Because of the close proximity of the two gangs. It's really volatile. Like, it's peaceful now, but all it needs is for a couple of people to do things wrong, and it'll flare up again.
Houses burning, people firing darts at each other, rock fights, you name it, and they're doing it. At this stage, the generic gangs are 7-7 and PSHT. They are the two largest gangs.
Why do they just like each other so much?
From what we can tell, it's just who's got the control of power, and that's all they're after.
They want power?
Yeah.
And they'll fight to get it, or kill to get it?
They will.
There's some lads up here, aren't there? Now, will these guys be gang affiliated?
Most likely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Buon noite.
Noite.
Yeah, play.
Yeah.
Definitely gang.
So can we get them to show us their arms and see whether they got any gang tats?
Yeah, they have any.
Now, you're looking for gang tattoos or gang markings, aren't you guys?
Yeah. That's right. 7-7 will have a number of markings on their arms, both their forearms and their biceps.
Yeah.
They'll also have them on their chest, and they'll also have them on their back.
Nothing on his arm.
On this occasion, the Aussies found no obvious sign of gang membership. But in East Timor, even the unaffiliated have a gang name, 00.
There's gang members in each village, but they've got a lot of 00 people who are more persuaded by whichever gang's in charge of the village.
Right.
A lot of them aren't full gang members themselves, but they will fight or else they will have repercussions to them.
But isn't that
their houses will get burnt down if they say, no, I want nothing to do with you.
Although the streets felt tense, it seemed to me like the Australians had the situation under control. But the next morning, I got a better sense of what the peacekeepers were up against.
There's a riot going on. UN forces are being stoned by the locals here. So, well, we're going to try and get there and find out exactly what's going on. A lot of people with guns. They're very happy to see us. Well, there's a big police presence here. They've just arrested a guy. They've got a guy going in the vehicle just over to me now. Basically, guys from over here went out onto the street and started throwing rocks at a UN police vehicle. They obviously retreated, then called for backup. When the backup turned up, they've retreated over to there. They've stopped throwing rocks. So at the moment, it's a bit of a standoff.
The incident gave me an insight into life here. But to really understand East Timor and why there are foreign peacekeepers on the streets, you need to understand its history of violence. The island of Timor lies between two of the region's superpowers, Indonesia and Australia. While the West is part of Indonesia, the East was a Portuguese colony for 400 years. But when the Portuguese left in 1975, the Indonesians invaded, starting a conflict that lasted 24 years and cost an estimated 250,000 Timorese and 10,000 Indonesian lives. In 1999, a referendum was finally held, and the Timorese voted to kick the Indonesians out. But the run-up to independence in 2000 was marked by an orgy of violence that tore the country apart. The UN is here to assist in the difficult process of nation-building. For although the Indonesians have gone, East Timor is still a traumatized country. Violence remains the favored way of resolving problems, and the gangs provide the foot soldiers to fight the resulting conflicts. Last year, talks were held to try and stop the gang violence. José Luis Sousa Santos, a former presidential bodyguard and youth worker, was there. I needed someone to get me closer to PSHT and 7-7, and José was the best option.
Thanks for meeting me, mate.
Yep, no problem.
I was keen to know about the roots of East Timor's gang culture.
The East Timorese are very proud on the fact that they come from a warrior culture. You know, this is, and if you look throughout the whole history, it's the one thing that, the one bit of identity that they haven't lost.
Is they're warriors.
That they're warriors, you know, that they're a fighting race against any odds. And what's happening with the gangs is basically the corruption of that warrior culture, of all that pride, of all that honour, of all that history.
Well, how organised are the gangs here?
They control the gambling, they control, I suppose, the low-level prostitution, the racketeering in the markets, protection rackets. When you realise, OK, you say, Guadalcanal, 37,000 militants, PSHT, 31,000 militants, 7-7, anything between, you know, 10,000 and 12,000 militants. When you look at the numbers,
it starts adding up to be
more than 10, 15% of the population.
Young men in gangs.
OK, for example, you see the PSHT graffiti of the heart. It's an Indonesian martial arts organisation, but it's also present in England, it's present in...
I've heard of it, mate. I've been to a place where they do it.
So it's...
Penjak Silat.
Yeah. Penjak Silat, exactly. So let me show you this.
There's some graffiti on the wall, yeah?
Yeah, some 7-7 graffiti. It's one of the ritual art gangs.
Right.
In East Timor, especially in regards to ritual art gangs, you have 7-7, which are characterised by the seven little scars up their arms. The leader or the holy man, the pure master, sort of makes little cuts and then rubs a special mix of blood of the sacrificed animal or this magical dust, which then makes the gang member, ties the gang member's life force to the gang.
Right.
But also makes them impervious to wounding or to being shot or, yeah, that's their belief.
Jose, do you think you could try and get me an introduction to some of these guys, if I could meet them, talk to them?
Yeah, it shouldn't be a problem. It shouldn't be a problem. I mean, if anything, these guys have a lot of pride in the organisation and the history of the organisation, so
they're willing to talk.
They're willing to talk and tell you their side of the story.
Because they're proud.
Exactly.
In part two, I meet the magic man who beat a bullet in the back and hang out with a martial arts army. A gang that outnumbers the police and military combined. East Timor has a reputation for violence, and signs of gang activity are everywhere. I've been here just a few days when I was put in touch with one of the biggest gangs on the island, PSHT.
Well, it's not often you get to meet a guy whose martial arts organisation has more members than the police, the army, and in this case, the United Nations peacekeepers combined. That's power for you. Portage? Buen dia.
Javi.
Thank you.
Fortagio de Jesus Maia de Andrade heads an estimated 31,000 followers of the martial art Penjak Silat. Its Indonesian roots have caused suspicion and accusations of collaboration with the old occupiers. But that hasn't prevented PSHT becoming one of the most powerful and influential groups in the country.
Balo, Forza. Balo, Parlamento,
There are other organisations on the island that, that occasionally clash, maybe, I think, with you sometimes. What are your views on those other organisations? Have you ever been hurt while you've been fighting or defending the organization?
Would
you mind showing me the injury where the arrow hit you?
There. See the scar where the arrow went in.
And there's another one up here. How did you get that one?
Having done a little penjack myself, I was curious to see Fortaggio's people doing their stuff, and they were only too happy to show me. Like most gangs or groups involved in conflict, PSHT consider themselves more sinned against than sinning. And watching them in action, I was beginning to think of them as just a nice community group. Until, that is, I got talking to some of the guys who train with Fortaggio. Then I met Mr. Lopez, a trainee policeman who once faced a gang of 150 people.
And they wanted to kill you?
They said, Lopez, come out. If you didn't come out, we will kill all of your family.
Were these people aligned to any other, like, COCA or to 77?
Oh, yeah, I recognize them very well. They are from 77, some of them from COCA, but I still talk with the guy, you know, the person, you know.
He's the leader, the person
who died. And suddenly he cut me, then I moved back. And I moved back, and I saw my blood, so they come out. And then, you know, I pretended that, you know, I almost dying. And I said, oh, my God, I'm dying. You know, everybody laughing and so on. And that's how they lose their control. And suddenly I took the samurai. Then I move. I said, now, Spere, you go. And then he want to attack me for the second time, right? Because he moved like this, or samurai like this. He want to cut me. Then I just, you know, like, move a little bit. Then I stab him.
You stab him, yeah?
Yeah.
What happened to this guy? This guy died? This guy you stabbed?
I didn't show.
But did they say what happened?
But I only remember I stuck him once.
Yeah, yeah. Did he die though?
I didn't know.
You don't know?
Yeah.
Did the police know?
Yeah, they suspicioned me that I'm the one who killed the guy.
Oh, you killed, so he did die then?
That's what they say.
That's what they say.
That's what they suspicioned me.
How is your arm now? Is it bad? Can I have a look?
Yeah.
He hasn't stopped you from doing the penjack though. You're still doing penjack, huh?
No, not yet. Can't wait.
Yeah, that's a good. He hit you there bad, huh?
Yeah, it's very bad. You want me to die?
He wants you to die, yeah?
Yeah.
Well, we've just spent an afternoon with PSHT, and I have to say I'm not only impressed with their martial arts skills, but also with the structure of their organisation. They say they're not a gang, but all the other gangs here seem to believe that they are. One thing's for sure, I've never met a gang that has such influence in virtually every strata of society here. They have members in high-ranking positions in the army and in the police, and they have a lot of influence here politically. Now I wanted to find 7-7. That evening, I met up with the Guardia Nacional Republica, or GNR, from Portugal, the former colonial power. They are respected on the streets here and well-placed to get me closer to the elusive ritual arts gang, who are PSHT's sworn enemies. Our first stop of the night was an internally displaced persons camp near our hotel. The camps are well-known trouble spots, providing the gangs with a ready source of manpower.
The local police have turned up, and now the GNR have shown they've backed off. They're letting the GNR guys go and do what they do.
The graffiti is an indication that this is 7-7 territory, but no one seems in a mood for talking. Trouble tends to melt away when the GNR arrive, so we moved on to another part of Dili.
I don't know, two days ago they threw rocks.
Yes.
They threw rocks in our house in 12 o'clock in the middle of night.
Yes.
And we don't know what
Who was
what's
it?
Going on. People from upstairs.
The lady you may have just heard screaming and ranting was only talking to me less than 40 seconds ago, very clearly in English, very concisely. As soon as she saw the people that she believed had been throwing rocks at her house, she flipped. And her hysteria was catching the men got involved as well. And a lot of those guys were wearing Acri Jazz T-shirts, which we know to be a gang round here. They denied to be being gang members. But, you know, whether it's gang-related or not, you can see how quickly things can change here. One second, very peaceful. The next minute, hysteria.
Young men here are often forced into gangs for self-protection. Jose took me to a project he'd set up himself to try and help kids avoid gang life.
So where are these kids from?
Just like from this neighbourhood. As you go through, you realise it's...
These kids, in a way, are potential gang members, aren't they?
They're ex-gang members.
Already?
Yeah. The story of Jose, for example. Jose is somebody that I've got a lot of respect for. He was a member, he used to be a member of PSHT. He then said, no, I don't want to be a member of any group, pulled out from it. He was hunted, he's still hunted.
For leaving?
Yeah. Not allowed to.
But once you're in.
Once you're in, you're in. This is what they use to protect themselves. Okay? This is the Rambambon.
Fuck.
Okay? This is what they fire it out of.
That's a blade, obviously, with a hook on it.
Yeah. So once it enters, you can't pull it out. It's a harpoon. Add one of these.
All right.
Straight in there. And I'll take it to him.
Jose was yet another victim of the state-of-the-art weapons that abound in this retro war. I wanted to know more about this sling and dart combo that seems to be the weapon of choice around here.
Our fixer, Maurizio, has managed to find someone who will show us how they make these darts and these slings here. It's an arrestable offence to possess one or to make one.
Danger! Danger! Get on the floor! The nigga right here! Sing it!
Been so long.
Sing it!
He's been on.
So that's all it takes. A handful of easily obtained hardware, including a 6-inch nail, and you've got a Ramba Ambon, one of the most frequently used weapons on the Timorese streets.
Hello.
It's gone in there. Obviously, it's traveled all the way through it.
up to the Oki. It's Kemp. Mm. Kemp of Essex. Try and hit that one there. One more go.
As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I take a look at my life and realize there's nothing left. Cause I've been blasting and laughing so long that even my mama thinks that...
My first Sunday in East Timor, the day on which the Timorese show the other side of their character. Despite the violence, this is a deeply religious country. All the gangs claim to have God on their side, and Catholicism has a massive influence on life here. On Sunday mornings, 70% of the Timorese attend church.
And on Sunday afternoons, thousands more Timorese come to places like this in search of less spiritual pursuits.
Gambling is a major part of the culture here, and cockfighting is a big money sport, with hundreds of dollars changing hands over a rooster's pugilistic potential. But I wasn't here as a punter. Jose had told me these weekly cockfights raise revenue for the gangs, and I wanted to see if I could make contact with 7-7. This guy's tattoo told me we'd come to the right place.
Just been given some contact details, and hopefully this piece of paper will lead us to 7-7.
2 days later, I went to Santa Cruz Cemetery to rendezvous with the man from 7-7. This was the scene of an infamous massacre in 1991, when Indonesian troops killed 100 mourners at a funeral. When 7-7 supporters claimed to have been saved from death by their membership of the ritual arts group, a gang legend was born. My contact, Mr. January, is a 7-7 survivor of the incident.
Do you believe that because you're a member of that gang and the spiritualism attached to that, that made you survive the attack?
Yeah. How fear tamba ho buatira nema mungkin to hindona semoris. Mas primero principal mane ita ema creatura ita maromak primero segun ita harebe tinumak. Tamba ho se cheti nema ko hindona semoris. Se cheti laya pronto mungkin urusne ho mate tene hela ratere.
Would you mind showing me where you were shot, please? It's here, yeah?
Yeah.
You can just see the hole. That's where it's gone in. I can understand why you believe you're invincible.
It had taken me a while to get to 7-7, a highly secretive organization that had played a big part in the resistance against Indonesia. But through Mr. January, I was put in touch with 7-7's president. Agostino Fernandez had invited me to witness a secret ceremony. But first, I was due for a crash course in 7-7's religious philosophy.
This is.
Esta é a nossa cultura, tradição da organização de 77. Não vê Rei Mouris Mahanes Anekres.
E da primeiro mundo, 00, toma e tina de um ruahito. Nesse 77 ninian. Adora crema. Hawa tahte tetan de hankwandu. Itani aman ho itaninan husik malu. Rai sinakupun. How hanesan ministério hanesan ministério de kinisim diretamente os nembro how la brane toban how hakat liu or sida husi dia nama or sida hau tukunu hau mate liu kadas hau saiba kareta bel soke hau motor bel soke hau tamane lia lulik lia maroma lia muru lia manas nela bel
how hatet. I'd be a liar to say I was following everything the president was telling me. But 77 is fundamentally a belief system that mixes Catholicism with pre-Christian animist tradition.
I'd be very scared if I was you.
In keeping with the secretive nature of 77, all their ceremonies take place after dark. This is what Jose had told me about. The magic powder, the sacrifice, and the seven cuts to tie Mr. January's life force to 77. It's the first time this ceremony has been shown on television. It's easy to be dismissive of 77's belief that they can be protected against everything, including bullets. But when you spend 20-odd years fighting a superior force like the Indonesians, a mythology like this would certainly help to inspire the troops. Like PSHT, 77 claimed to do nothing more than act defensively against attacks by their rivals.
Hello, man.
A senior member of 77 reads the pig's entrails to see what the future holds.
I just said that the knife is as sharp as the owner and as bad as the owner. So you just said that the other side of the liver sort of represents us and that we're clean, that we're okay and we're good to be here, which is a bit of a relief. This is a highly religious country, but kids are also brought up here from an early age to believe in ghosts and spirits. So it's not that strange to find a gang that believes in both animism and Catholicism. That said, some cuts in my arm with some sacred mud rubbed into it and a pig reading wouldn't convince me to take 9 rounds in the chest. Rumours rapidly become facts here. So a gang that's 30,000 strong that believes it's invincible has to be a force to be reckoned with.
In part 3, I come face to face with the results of gang violence and learn about the combustible politics of the world's youngest democracy.
I think we should go.
I had been in East Timor for over a week and was growing used to the volatility of life here. Now, I was on my way to Dili Hospital. Our fixer, Maurizio, had heard of a guy who'd ended up there after being beaten up in a gang attack.
Does he know why he was attacked?
He doesn't know.
Does he know how many people attacked him?
He said many people. This is Mr. Duarte.
I'm dressing his wound.
They had to cut the dart out. Was the dart in or did they pull it out?
They have to do the surgery to remove the dart.
Thank you.
And they had more than one dart, and one dart hit him, yeah?
Yeah, one dart.
And then stones.
And then stones in his left face. And
yeah.
Then...
So his jaw's completely broken, that's why they've wired it together, so he can't move it, so it's stabilised, yeah?
Yeah.
So they left him for dead, yeah?
Yes.
They thought they killed him?
They thought they killed him and then they left him there.
He's very lucky because he could have bled to death, couldn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, I hope, wish him well, yeah? Just say I hope he has a speedy recovery.
He was the care pai recupera la lais para que ele fila bom.
No one was willing to say what had caused the attack on Mr. Duarte, but I noticed that the temperature on the streets had been rising in line with the political climate. The politics of East Timor are complex, and the gangs are heavily involved. I have been told that power was the name of the game, and political influence is the ultimate goal. In 2005, Corker announced that they were supporting one of the major parties, and other gangs are known to have party political affiliations. But when I went to visit PSHD again, Fortagio seemed determined to play the whole thing down.
Your enemies say that you wield significant political power in this country. Is that true?
La los. Ilele se sirale alesa ilaidet mesla tamali mahari agore imhari ras. Amene alorin politika alorin treina. Ilele ame hatenet mak treina. Orisau lebe ke bela diri los orisau politik lah. Si amene members barak mebe ambel kontrola tamba. Amene orisau le ya terorganisir. Baibe alas baik per ame tuzo amene buka mangwale. Pues noring ema alsai ema. Emira manusia ember budilur tabunar dan salah. Ini nih.
I was getting used to gang members emphasizing the passive nature of their organizations. But the fact remains that Fortagio is only standing in as head of PSHT because the real leader is in jail on weapons charges. After his arrest, PSHT's offices were destroyed by 7-7.
Your actual president is in prison at the moment. Can you tell me what exactly happened?
Abre presidente la sala, niene corva, vai besar e fal pelak. É baser agora ataca é na base, suno uma, suno a minha secretaria, a da usa sa, oh é baser de bem bas fali. É de mami triste, mas é a mim compreende tamba. Se tu sao gaste, crise gaste, é a mim compreende, mas é a mim se halo tudo tchara huku, a mim halo te la pora, mano.
My time in East Timor was drawing to an end, but to find out more about the gang's political influence, I decided to meet up once again with Jose.
This is it's part of the whole beauty of it, I suppose, where you're not really just dealing with the criminal underground here, and you're dealing with, you know, organisations which can reach into all levels of society. Last year, where the gangs were mainly a political tool for destabilisation.
They were used again as rent-a-crowd, yeah?
As rent-a-crowd, as foot soldiers, as protection for ministers, as protection for opposition leaders.
If that's the case presently, what's the next step?
I mean, if... At the moment, you know, a lot of this violence seems to be controlled by the political leaders or political elites or, you know,
yeah,
people that want to cause this. But as you know, these gangs, you know, grow in, you know, in their numbers and they become more and more proficient in what they do, and as they lose their political backers, what are they going to turn into? Are they just going to go away? They're not just going to go away.
You don't create that situation and then expect to just leave it. And, it's going to fester, isn't it? Concerns about the gang problem here go right to the top. President Ramos Horta convened a meeting with the gangs last year to try and broker a truce. Now, he's agreed to talk to us.
The president is a Nobel Peace Prize winner, but it seems even he'd lost patience with the gangs.
I was very angry. I said, you know, you are a disgrace. Your attitude has made martial arts synonymous with crime. I told them, here in these four rooms, I'm going to live, and you people can, you will stay on and talk. If you want to kill each other, help yourselves. You do it, kill yourselves here. On the other hand, if you want to engage in dialogue, talk rationally with each other, and be of service to your own country, well, you have a chance. I'll come back a few hours from now. Either I'll find some of you dead, or you have reached some agreement. I was told that when I left, they start talking to each other, and they cried. They were embarrassed, and they signed that document, which, you know, but some of them, till today, they have attempted to behave, but among the seven or groups that signed the document, few of them, a few hours later or two, 3 days later, you know, start violating that very agreement they signed.
How much political influence do you think these martial arts groups or gangs or movements wield politically in the country? And is that a concern for you?
No, they do not have a political influence as such. One major martial arts group called Korka, they are formally affiliated with the largest political party here. But this particular group is one of those that I met, and many of the meetings I have had with them, I was very blunt, very robust with them, and they have behaved. If and when the government is ready to really kickstart the economy with major investments and spread the wealth in the city, particularly rebuilding housing for the poor, most of these people will gradually disappear into the mainstream. Danger!
Danger! But within hours of our interview, President Korta's optimism began to seem misplaced. His announcement of a new government led to an explosion of violence. 77's political allies were the losers, and their supporters in the IDP camp near our hotel quickly took to the streets.
These guys to my right of me, the guys that have just been throwing rocks and setting fire to the tyres. The army have just gone up there, New Zealand Army and GNR. They've put the tyres out, but they're still ready to go, as you can see. They're not very happy about us filming them. This is exactly what we've been told about all the time that we've been here. And it's very easy here to get a false sense of security. People are very, very friendly. They're very, very happy to see you. They smile. And then something very small, or something very large in this case, a new Prime Minister, has triggered off the violence. As I say, they put the tyres out now. We'll see if it escalates. But everyone around here is saying it's going to be a very long night tonight, and it will spontaneously click off at different points through Dili for the next 24 hours. Danger! The nigga, what? Get on the floor!
What? The nigga right here! Get him up! What? Danger! As the IDP camp appeared to be calming down, violence flared up in another part of Dili.
Fry rocks. Hey, mate, you all right?
Yeah, you just want to wait over there or you might get fucking...
Really? Is that bad? You'll be all right.
Once again, it was a game of cat and mouse between the heavily armed peacekeepers and the rioters, who quickly melted away.
We're down at the front there. They're firing tear gas, so the wind's changed. So we've just gassed. Everyone's backing off. It hasn't got gas masks, so coming back this way.
A As night fell, we got reports of fires being started.
I'm a fire starter, touristic fire starter.
We mentioned before how arson is used in this country by gangs and by people who are unhappy. This was a place where many of the records for the country were kept, and as of tonight, the place doesn't exist anymore. I think we should go.
I'm a fire starter.
That night, Dili went to sleep with parts of the city in flames. And by the next morning, arsonists had set light to a building right opposite our neighbouring IDP camp.
When Indonesian occupiers built the statue of Christ the King in 1995, many of the Timorese said that Jesus looked out to sea because he couldn't bear to look upon what was happening in East Timor. Well, now the occupiers have gone, but so many other problems still remain. And at the root of most of them is the country's gang culture. This place has such potential, but if it's ever to be realised, something has to be done about the poverty and the unemployment here. Otherwise, East Timor will turn into just another gangster's paradise.
Ross's next journey takes him closer to home, to a territory with links to many families across the UK. Ross Kemp in Afghanistan. He's on Sky One on Monday the 19th of November at 9 p.m. If you're looking forward to Prison Break, you'll have to wait for a couple of weeks. America have ceased and we shall cease with them until Monday the 5th of November at 10 p.m. here on Sky One.